So good afternoon, everyone. A very warm welcome to this webinar hosted by National Company Law Tribunal and Appellate Tribunal Bar Association. This is the effort of Bar to bring about the development, the knowledge sharing with the members, with the stakeholders, with the professionals. And the Bar has planned a series of such webinars from time to time, which will be done during the henceforth we are going forward. So just for the reference of the panelists and audience, let me inform that today we have a very interesting participants audience to this webinar. We have received more than 600 registrations and still pouring in. And the people, the participants who are in the webinar consist of chartered accountants, lawyers, company secretary, ICWA, insolvency professionals, and various other business stakeholders, home buyers who are there who want to know certain webs and a lot of clarifications. Even prior to webinar, we have received so many questions. We'll try to answer maximum whatever is possible during this webinar. Otherwise, we'll try to make a Q&A of those session questions which we have received, and we will get through this webinar. And Bar may release those Q&A. I mean, we can explore this possibility if this can be done later on. Friends, today's topic of the webinar is most appropriate and has been held at a very relevant time. The impact on home buyers and CIRP of real estate companies post COVID-19. Friends, the IBC has been developing at a very fast pace since inception. We have seen the days when we were filing Section 8, 9, 10 applications. Home buyers were introduced later on as financial creditors. There were threshold limits. There were judgments by Honorable Supreme Court, NCLT, on various aspects related to home buyers and insolvency related to RPs. We have new concept of reverse CIRP and various other things are developing and still developing. Lot of amendment has come recently. We have amendment. So a lot of deliberations are going on the implication, especially in the situation where COVID-19 is there and still it is growing at the moment. People are very much scared of COVID-19. In this given situation, a lot of RPs who are in the projects, they are facing difficulty in holding COCs, visiting the plants, projects, getting the resolution plan done. So lot many difficulties are coming, timelines are skipping. So how to deal with, so we try to as much as with the experience of our panelists to cover in this webinar. So friends, just to introduce in today's panel to discuss all these issues related to home buyers and CIRP, we have first of our panel is Shri Viren Gadaji. He is senior advocate, you all may know he is a senior advocate from Delhi High Court and is president of NCLT and AT Bar Association. He has more than 4 decades of experience, a huge experience dealing with civil and corporate commercial litigation, are representing before NCLT and various other courts. He has been appointed on various committees for governance and accounting standards by SEBI. He has been president of ICSI in 2000. So he has a tremendous, we are lot to learn and to hear from him. So most welcome, sir. We think at the end of the webinar, we'll be enriched with your knowledge and deliberations. Welcome to this webinar. Friends, the second panelist of our webinar today is Mr. Rakesh Kumar. He is, all of us know him, he's secretary of the NCLT and AT Bar Association. He has a tremendous experience in dealing with corporate commercial litigation matters, and he has been appearing before NCLT regularly in many of the renowned cases. But apart from this, He has played a very vital role as being a secretary to the Bar Association and at various events, activities to the standard which the bar is, he has played a very important role. I'm glad to inform that today the NCLT and AT Bar Association has more than 600 members. So those participants who would like to become the member of our bar, all addresses are there. You may mail us, mail the bar, and you will get the response immediately. So I think with this background, I would first invite Mr. Rakesh Kumar to deliberate upon various aspects of home buyer and CRP on after in this given in COVID situation. Mr. Rakesh Kumar, most welcome.
Good evening, everyone. On this webinar, I first of all convey my thanks to the Sameer who has given me this wonderful opportunity to speak on this subject. This is a very burning area in the CRP process, real estate insolvency. So in my today presentation, I will first, Sameer, I would like to share my screen.
Rakesh, you may adjust your mic. I think some of the audiences are not able to hear you properly. You may please fix the things here, if it is possible.
Is it? Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you, but it's little less. Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, please. Yes.
So friends, this is a very important subject related to the home buyers. So in my presentation, first of all, I would like to refer what are the remedies so far available under the law for the home buyers for their grievances. So the home buyers initially had the remedy, still they have the remedies to file the consumer complaints against the builders for not non-completing of their projects, not giving them the units or in time. They were filing complaints before the District Consumer Commission, State Consumer Commission, National Consumer Commission under the Consumer Protection Act. Then thereafter, the further development of law and the RERA came into picture, and Section 18 of the RERA giving again the opportunity to the unit holders to exercise the right. If in case the project is delayed, they can ask for their money back along with interest, or they can ask for the possession of the unit. So this was also one of the effective remedy. The third remedy, which is subject matter of discussion today, is the IBC Code 2016. This I will discuss with some of the judgments and the circulars, how it was developed in the IBC Code. And there were two other remedies for the home buyers, which they generally exercise in case of real estate projects getting delayed and the promoters siphon off the money and diverting the funds. So those remedies are even fallen as a criminal complaint under IPC. Many home buyers, they have filed the complete criminal complaints. And as per my knowledge, many builders are behind the bars for cheating with the home buyers.
Mr. Rakesh, there are some messages that your voice is not clear to the audience.
Just a minute. Just a minute.
Yes. Yes, please.
Can you
yes,
hear me?
Yes, now it is good. Now it is good.
Can you hear me?
Yes, it is better. Very good.
Just a moment.
Yes.
Now, Sameer, can you hear me?
Yes, yes. It is fine. Very good. You can proceed. Okay. Yes.
So, friends, I was discussing what was the rights available to the home buyers under the law. The first right I had referred, which they had consumer, they have filing consumer complaints before the District Consumer Commission, State Consumer Commission, National Consumer Commission as per the pecuniary jurisdiction. Then thereafter, the Section 18 of the RERA, it is giving remedy to home buyers to claim their money along with interest. in case of delay of project, and they can also ask for the possession of their units. Then this remedy of IBC code 2016 came, which I will discuss. Apart from this home buyers, they were also filing criminal complaints against the builders, those who have cheated and siphoned off the funds. And as per my knowledge, many builders are behind the bars under this remedy. Collectively, they filed the criminal complaints of cheating, criminal breach of trust, forgery, etc. The other remedy, which is also very important, is the constitutional remedy. In some of the cases, home buyers collectively directly approach the Honorable Supreme Court of India or the Honorable High Court. Like in JP case and Unity case, I will discuss. And the Honorable Supreme Court has entertained those grievances of home buyers and passed the very important directions to the builders. Now, how this remedy of IBC Code 2016 starts for the home buyers? The initiation was through the Nikhil Mehta judgment. Honorable NCLT had earlier held that the home buyer will not fall under the definition of the financial creditor, because the remedy under IBC Code 2016 could be invoked by either by the operational creditor or by the financial creditor. So some of the petitions were being filed by the home buyers contending they fall under the financial creditor because the assured return was there. But that was not entertained by the NCLT, but Honorable NCLAT in Nikhil Mehta judgment held they will fall under the definition of financial creditor. And thereafter, this Chitra Sharma, this is also important in sequence, because this JP matter, the Supreme Court in Article 32 had passed an interim order in this matter that home buyers can participate in the COC meetings. So this was another development. And thereafter, the IBC amendment came on 17th of August 2018, where the home buyers were included in the financial creditors, and their money which they have given for this real estate project was having the commercial effect of borrowing, and they were included in the financial creditor. That amendment was challenged before the Honorable Supreme Court in Pioneer Urban Land, and the Supreme Court upheld the amendment in Pioneer Urban Land. And thereafter, lot many petitions were being filed. So the buyers, builders were agitating that there should be some limitation to approach the NCLT for this purpose by the home buyers. So the amendment came, IBC Amendment Ordinance 2019, putting a threshold minimum limit to exercise this remedy by the home buyers, either the 100 members or the 10% of the 10% of the 10% total members. This ordinance was challenged in Manish Sharma versus Union of India before the Honorable Supreme Court. It is still pending. And then the Amendment Act came, which replaced the ordinance, and it is also challenged in Karvi Investor versus Union of India. So, friend, this is so far the journey of the home buyers for the remedies which is available under the law to them, and they are before now their fate is before the Honorable Supreme Court for approaching the Honorable NCLT. For their rights, they can approach, but with collectively. Individually, they can't because of these amendments. So now, this is very important. What sort of resolution process plan can be passed in the real estate companies? What are the judicial precedents so far? One is the project-wise insolvency, group insolvency, reverse insolvency. Sir, Mr. Virendra Ganda, senior advocate, he will cover this issue comprehensively, project-wise insolvency and reverse insolvency. As far as this group insolvency is concerned, this concept is getting momentum through some of the judicial order being passed by the Honorable NCLT and Honorable NCLAT. One of the some of the important orders are Venu Gopal Dhoot versus State Bank of India, and State Bank of India versus Videocon Industries. In these two matters, the Honorable NCLT Principal Bench had directed that one adjudicating authority can take up the insolvency of the group companies together. For example, one group company is based in Mumbai, one is in Kolkata, one is in Delhi. So together, one adjudicating authority can take up the matter. So this was the issue in these matters. And finally, in Edelweiss versus Sachet Infrastructure, the Honorable NCLAT, it was related to the real estate project. There were five group companies. Honorable NCLAT has held, yes, this group insolvency can be initiated in all these five companies, and some directions were passed. So the momentum has come for the group insolvency. And apart from this, in Chitra Sharma versus Union of India, which is JP matter, and Vikram Chatterjee, which is Amrapali, here the Supreme Court in the Article 32 has also passed the comprehensive directions for the group insolvency or the group revival. This IBA report has come of the working group on the group insolvency has published in September 2019. It has given the various concept and recommendation for the amendment in the act. It has recommended that for the group companies, if there is a problem together, the joint application file for all the group companies for the group insolvency, and single adjudicating authority can be approached, single RP can be appointed, there can be a group credit committee or group coordination committee. So this, every my friends can can read this IBBA report on working group on group insolvency. This is very important. It has given the comprehensive background of the group insolvency. Then these three judgments, I believe, sir will cover in the project-wise insolvency and reverse insolvency. The Honorable Supreme Court has dealt with the group, as I said, the group insolvency matters in Amrapali and JP Group. In Amrapali, the Honorable Supreme Court had passed a strict directions to the enforcement director for the investigation against the builders. There were 40 companies, 42,000 home buyers. And what was the outcome? What was the outcome of this matter? That the Honorable Supreme Court had directed only two resolution applicant will participate. One is Suraksha Security and other is NBFC. NBBC. And the important takeout from this judgment was that the government dues, that is Noida authority dues, that they can recover from the attached assets. Even the financial creditor claim, financial institution claim could be recovered from the attachment of the other assets of the promoter, not from the home buyer's assets. So there were very important directions which were passed in this matter. And the JP Group also, the Honorable Supreme Court has passed substantial directions. One direction was, even this was the first direction regarding the timeline process, which was over. Supreme Court had exercised the jurisdiction under Article 142 of the Constitution, passing the direction even beyond 180, 220 or 330 days. The 90 days period was given to complete the resolution process. And it was directed no fresh resolution plan will be entertained. Now, friends, I would deal with some of the critical aspects of the CRB process in the real estate companies, which I have dealt with, which was very important. And this is a state where RP has to be vigilant. The first category is the identification of claim. As and when the real estate CRP starts, the biggest problem is the identification of claim. Some of the claims which are backed by the securities, some of the claims which are not backed by the securities. But in real estate sector, the promoters, they enter into various type of contracts which are sometimes dubious in nature. And on the basis of those contracts, the creditor claims he could fall under this financial creditor, secure creditor list or with the security interest list. So this is a very important stage. Then the categorization of claims. This is also a very important categorization of claims. Like in some of the real estate matter, the government authority, for example, in Noida, Noida authorities have given the land on lease to various builders. Now, builder is at default of paying the lease money. So Noida authority is claiming that they should fall under the definition of financial creditor, secure creditor. But RP are holding them, the operational creditor, their claim as an operational creditor. So the litigation started and matter even went up to Honorable Enclave and they were upheld as a financial creditor, but still some of the forums are taking the view they are the operational creditor. This is very important aspect because it will change the voting percentage of the COC. The third important aspect in CRB process of real estate is the voting percentage dispute. This is a very important issue here. In the COC process of real estate companies, for example, there are 60% creditors who are home buyers, financial creditor home buyers, 40% normal financial creditors. Now there is an amendment under section 25, subsection 3A, came on 16th August 2019. This amendment provides that if there is a voting of the home buyers, if they vote more than 51%, that will be considered their total percentage. If 51% vote in favor of any resolution, then it will be considered 100%. So for example, in any resolution plan, if the 31% vote in favor of the resolution, it would be 60%. Then there will be no relevance for the 40% of the financial creditors. Because after having the 60% more votes, their plan will be approved. So other financial creditors are at disadvantage. I believe this provision is subject to challenge before the Honorable Supreme Court. This is creating difficulty in many matters. Then the challenge of preferential, fraudulent, undervalued transactions. RP also faces in real estate companies the challenges of promoter entering into subcontracts with the third parties who have the possession of the land, who have some different kind of rights with the properties of the corporate debtor. So this is also another challenge which the RP has to be very vigilant about in real estate projects. Many applications are there before the NCLT on this issue. The collaborator issues are also very important issues. In most of the cases, it is the land who gives the land to the developer and there's a collaboration agreement. Those landowner has a right over the FAR area of the project and the dispute starts. And now there is a difficult for the RP how to place those collaborators, landowners in the category of financial creditors. There are some litigations going on. It is also an important subject to be determined through the litigation, through the judicial forums. Then the government sector reliefs challenge. This government sector, in most of the resolution plan of the real estate companies, I have seen the reliefs are being sought for the waiver of the license charges, waiver for the development of the land. And there are crores of rupees which are outstanding towards this. And resolution applicant is under the impression it would automatically be waived. And I have seen the government authorities are not filing their claims and not coming before the NCLT to agitate such resolution plans. Recently, there is a Mumbai NCLT judgment just 1 week before that once you seek any relief, it does not mean automatically you will get that relief. It is subject to the government authority considering that relief. So this is also a debatable issue, how it will be settled. It will impact on the real estate projects because there's a substantial amount of payment is related to the government dues in the resolution plans.
Mr. Rakesh Kumar, here there is one question. For example, if the government authorities or statutory authorities, they are not coming forward with their claim, generally it happens many of the projects, their claims, they are not coming forward and they come at a very later stage. By that time, if they come at a later stage, the resolution plan, everything goes haywire. So what do you think? What is the fate if they are coming at a very late stage, they are not taking care initially? Then what happens?
See, if I go by the judgment of SR of the Honorable Supreme Court, which has propounded the clean slate theory, once the plan is approved and creditors are considered, then game is over. But here some distinction is there. It is a recurring dues of the government on the land. So it has to be again redetermined whether their dues will be erased or they may again claim that because it will be recurring in nature. So it has to be seen. There are disputes pending in these issues.
So I think home buyers, by approving the plan, they should see all these things also.
it's very important for the resolution plan. When they are conceding the resolution plan, in most of the resolution plan I have seen, they are seeking the waiver of 50 crore, 100 crore rupees of this government dues, and this will have an impact. And the another important issue is the change of resolution professional in the real estate matter, CRP process. There is a one Bangalore NCLT judgment which says that once the real estate matters reach up to a certain stage, the RP should not, though under section 22 is the prerogative of the COC to replace the RP. But here in this matter on NCLT, Bangalore said, no, we will not change the RP here at this stage. Because very important stage, new RP cannot take over the charge. Though that judgment is subject to challenge, but in my experience also, RP at the critical stage is difficult to change because he get acquainted with all the stakeholders of the real estate. Like he meet with the home buyers, he meet with the government authority, many stakeholders, and all of a sudden he gets changed. It becomes very difficult situation to resolve the real estate project.
Yeah, it means that in the projects which where RP has advanced to a very certain far level, you know, in most of the real estate projects, there are various forces working together. And if the RP, at least for his defense, if he is ousted from the project, so at least there is an argument which can be built upon this judgment.
Yes, the Bangalore NCLT says, no, it is, we will examine this. This judgment is there.
Yeah.
I will give the name of the judgment shortly.
Yeah.
Then the other issue is the whether the home buyers will be the secured creditor or unsecured creditor. This is also very important issue under section 53. As far as I have read all the judgments and the law, my point of view is once the home buyers gives the advance payment for the property in the project, they are not simply the financial creditor. They are the secured financial creditor because that is backed by the security interest of their unit. So this issue has not been finally settled, though has been referred in some of the judgment on the peripheral issues, but not finally. Then this latest judgment, it is very also very important, is the Maharashtra Seamless Honorable Supreme Court judgment, which provides that even the resolution plan come even below the liquidation value. I believe the as per my opinion, this judgment is based on per encarium. The Honorable Supreme Court in para 26 has stated that there is no provision in the IBC code which provides that the plan cannot become below the liquidation value. Whereas if we see the section 30 subsection 4, read with section 53, it categorically provides that that the payment made to the dissenting financial creditor should not be left. I would like to read the section 30 subsection 4. The committee of creditor may approve a resolution plan by vote of not less than 66% of voting share of the financial creditor.
Mr. Rakesh, here one question is, I'll just pause here, that what if the home buyer have already made full payment for all, at suppose 95% payment they have made. So then what is the state? I mean, they are secured, unsecured, what kind of?
As per my opinion, they are financial creditor and they are also the secured creditor because their interest is backed by the allotment letter. They have the right over the property. They have the civil rights.
But I think it will be seen in the light that how much, I mean, just if a home buyer has given say 10,000 or a lakh for a unit of 1 crore, I mean, it has to be seen in that light whether to what extent he has created the security interest.
Yes. And this Honorable Supreme Court has not considered this section in judgment. The manner of distribution proposed, which may take into account the order of priority amongst creditors as laid down in subsection 1 of section 53, including the priority and value of the security interest of a secured creditor. So the Supreme Court said there is no provision. There is a provision. So otherwise, there will be a collapse of for the financial creditor other than the secured financial creditor. Like for example, the example given earlier, in the COC, there are 60% members and 40% members. In the home buyers case, if the 60% home buyers are there, they passes the resolution plan with the 31% vote, and they can give the haircut to the other financial creditor to the 10%, and their liquidation value is 30%. So they are getting 10%. So this is a completely discrimination. This cannot be allowed because it will go against Section 30, Subsection 4, and Section 53. So other financial creditors, those who are secured, they should not get less than to their liquidation value. And otherwise, this judgment will demolish their interest in the CRV process, particularly in the real estate companies. Then status of the suspended board of directors. This is also very important. RP should be very vigilant because he has...
Mr. Rakesh, here Ekbred, on the previous point, liquidation, for example, if the liquidation value of the whole may be less, or then also how does the secured creditor, who's, he would still be limited to his liquidation value, or how it is?
No, it is proportion. Whatever is the value, residual value comes is a liquidation value. Mm. So whatever the values come is proportion to that. They cannot be given lesser than their liquidation value.
So then if, so what implication is coming that if a resolution plan is being passed by certain class of financial creditors where the secured creditors are not taken care of, where their share which they are getting is going below liquidation, so they have a point here to raise objection against such plans?
Yes, because there is a statute, there is a law.
Yes.
Which I'm referring to Section 30, Subsection 4. So this remedy is there. Because the Honorable Supreme Court in Para 26 of this judgment says we have not seen any provision. One provision is there.
Yeah.
And this the conduct of the COC in real estate CRP process is very important because the home buyer stakes are there. At sometime I have also attended the COC meetings in real estate CRP processes. Home buyers are very aggressive. RP has to be very vigilant to deal with the home buyers' concern. There should be well coordination with the authorized representative. And another one is the instant filing of status report with the learned adjudicating authority by the RP. The instant status report is required because sometimes the allegations are leveled against the RP that you have not apprised the Honorable Tribunal. So it is a prerogative of the RP to instantly file all the status report with respect to CRP process, particularly real estate. In every matter also, but it's a very sensitive matter. Then this voting of the resolution plan and the whether simultaneous voting can be allowed at different plans. See, there was a controversy on this issue also. Earlier, when the plans were invited, if there are 3-4 plans, evaluation matrix is there, whichever is the best plan, that was putting for the voting. But now the IBBI has come up with a circular. IBBI has come up with a suggestion in February 2020 that there can be a voting on the resolution plans simultaneously if all the other resolution plans are compliant with the laws. But this has to be formally introduced, but the working paper is there of the IBBI of February 2020 of this year. So this will resolve many problems. In one of the case, one of the resolution professional has already invoked this provision and has done this simultaneous voting, which we are challenging in some of the matter, which so far is not allowed, but IBBI has introduced this concept. Then right of home buyer based on cash transactions. This is very important in the real estate project. Many home buyers have paid substantial part of the payment through cash. And when they file their claim, the RP do not entertain their claim. And they file the application. This is very important because with the SR judgment, once the plan is approved, you can't approach thereafter. You have to agitate your all issues before the RP and then before the NCLT, before passing of the resolution plan. So in one of the matter, which is a NEEL infrastructure, the Honorable NCLT principal bench has passed this very important order. It's saying even after passing of the resolution plan, the home buyer will have a civil right to pursue the civil remedy with respect to their cash transaction. Their right will not go. There are orders passed by the principal bench. So their rights are secured, and this is a very important development. And home buyer should be exiled. When the resolution plan is being prepared or the claims are being collated, they should be exiled Because once this exercise is over, they will not get anything. They have to agitate at this stage. Then post challenges to the approval of resolution plan in real estate sector. This I will cover in the next slide. Then there's another is, can there be a liquidation real estate project on the IBC code? This is the matter which I have dealt in real estate projects of the CRP. I don't think so there can be a liquidation in the real estate projects. Ultimately, in the real estate project, some resolution plan has to come. Because in most of the cases, there are some initial development, some partial tower has been built up, some initial payments are made. So someone will come, home buyers will not leave their project. So now there are development, home buyers has got approved their plans. In one of the matter which I'm handling is a Noida based project. Their home buyers has come up have come up with a project real resolution plan, and their plan has been approved. Now it is pending sanction before the Honorable NCLT. So these are the development. Now home buyers are coming forward to complete the this CRP process of real estate company, and they are very much interested. And if there is a unsold inventory is there or something, some more FAR areas is there, they can definitely pitch in and they can come up with a resolution plan. And then the challenge of the dues of statutory authorities resulting in collapse of the plan. Now in one of the matter which I have handled of the Noida authority is a Noida based builder. The plan was passed. Home buyer had introduced the plan. Plan was passed. But Noida authority had cancelled the lease. So once the lease is cancelled, it was cancelled way back in 2015. Now the Honorable NCLT has passed an order. You approach the Honorable Supreme Court in view of the Amrapali judgment. So now these are the important aspects which needs to be looked into the CRP process of the real estate project. Now these challenges post COVID-19, what I've seen. Now the resolution plans which have already been passed, there is no exemption already because pre-COVID those resolution plans were passed with respect to the implementation subject to COVID. This will create difficulty for those resolution plans. And contingencies of the lockdowns were not looked into those resolution plans. That is another additional factor post-COVID. The real estate projects will face the problems which they have to deal with these problems. And this is very important aspect. The section 74 of the now this INB code provides, if there's a non-compliance of the resolution plan, there's a criminal consequences. Now, after this COVID-19, how the real estate will deal with this problem, because if there is already approved resolution plan, either they have to implement it as per the terms of the plan, or they have to get the exemption. But otherwise, there is a criminal consequences which may follow for the non-implementation of plan. Then there will be challenges for the real estate sector, like there's a labor issues. They can't find the labor, raw material issue. Then the another difficulty would be there to sell the unsold inventory in this crisis. And there will be for the plans which are in pipeline, or those for the pending CRP process, it will be difficult for the new resolution applicant to take over the new projects because of the COVID-19. And the last is the CRP process beyond 330 days. There are already circular issued by the Honorable NCA NCLAT and the IBBI. And I believe that in view of the SR judgment, these timelines will be taken leniently even if it crosses the 330 days. This is my personal view. And important consideration, these are the few I would like to share with my friends. These are the some bullet points, 8-9 points. What are in the minds of the home buyers? If someone wants to get its plan sanctioned in the real estate project, what are the, because we have attended some of the COC meetings of the real estate project, these are the important consideration for the home buyers. Final cost of the project should be fixed. Now the home buyers, they want that whatever the project cost, that should be clear in the resolution plan. It should not be any contingency based. And there should be certainty the money which is to be recovered from home buyers. It is not that they should be again on a contingent. Kehte hain doodh ka chhala jala chhach ko phook phook kar peeta hai. So home buyer, they don't want. They want certainty in the plans. and dues of the statutory authority, like a statutory authority dues in the future, new demands will come. Home buyers, they don't like if the statutory authority demands are imposed on them in the resolution plans. And further, the real estate project should not be based on the recovery through the forensic audit or the preferential transaction amounts. Home buyers don't consider it. Then resolution plan should not be dependent on the information memorandum only. The applicant should do our own due diligence report. Otherwise, the applicant cannot save itself from merely the on the basis of the information memorandum. And the home buyers, they would not like to pay the extra money to the resolution applicant. And pending working of the existing home buyer who already taken possession of the units of project shall be completed without any extra cost. So whatever the pending work is to be done in the plan, it should be mentioned how their work will be completed, those who have already taken the possession. Here it's also important, this is important issue. RP generally faces the problem in the real estate projects, whether the possession should be given or not. Some of the financial creditors, they take the objection, possession should not be given to the home buyers unless our money is settled. But in one of the judgment of Honorable Enclet, it has observed that even the possession for the fit outs can be given, but there is a passing reference only. But this is a very also critical situation for the RP in the CRP process of real estate. Then the quality of construction is very important in the resolution plan, how the towers will be built, how the houses will be built up, and there should be a quality auditor for the said process. Then this design of the building of flat should not be changed unless there is a majority voting on the said aspect. And the resolution applicant should not cancel the flat of the home buyers who are unable to pay the demand unless some 90 days period notice or some notice is given. I have seen generally resolution applicant mention that if this money is not paid within 30 days, we will cancel the allotment. Then resolution applicant should have a capacity to refund the amounts. There should be some performance guarantee. It is not that in air the plan is introduced. Then there should be some corpus of interest-free maintenance security collected by the CD, and that should be transferred by the resolution applicant to the residential welfare association. Home buyers are very concerned about this money which they had deposited, and the resolution plan should show the cash flow of the resolution applicant. And if there is any breach of law or there is something contingency comes, the home buyer should not be burdened with those contingency or the penalties or charges. So these are some of the points which we have noticed in the COC meeting of the home buyers where they were considering the resolution plans, which I would like to share with my friends. So these are the important considerations which I have discussed. I will conclude my presentation on this.
Thank you, Mr. Rakesh. It was really a wonderful session, and I think we all have gained knowledge and information from your session, and we'll try to take a certain Q&A after we have heard Gana sir. So friends, with this we will have a Q&A session in the last after we have heard Mr. Ganda. So sir, I think your connection was lost when we were introducing you. So friends, now Ganda sir is here. So Ganda sir, you are most welcome. So to deliver your session, please. Ganda sir, Mr. Ganda.
Thank you, Samir. We have heard very elaborate and exhaustive presentation by Rakesh on the issues pertaining to the real estate industry. Some of the issues which I would deal with, they are very peculiar to real estate industry. Let me first, before I start my actual presentation, let me first point out the actual differences which a real estate industry has as compared to the other industries. Now, in case of a real estate company, A company can have multiple projects, multiple locations, different regions, and even in the same project, they'll have multiple towers. But there can be a situation, and in fact, in most of the cases, a company has successfully executed several projects, given possession, and some of the flats in those projects are still with the company, shown as an asset, maybe unsold stock, or even if the flats are sold, but actual sale deed has not been registered for pending some payment. So those assets will be shown in the company's balance sheet as a company's assets. Amount received will be shown as a creditor. But the otherwise the projects are complete. Now, in some of the cases, even a tower, suppose one of the tower has about 21 stories, it's only complete up to 10 floors. Now 10 floors are complete, the flat buyers are staying there. They are given possession, but the top 10, 11 floors, they have not been constructed, and the flat buyers of those floors are in a problem. So these are the peculiar situation. And in some of the cases, suppose the projects are staying in a different, are situated in a different states. So they'll be governed by the statutory approvals of those respective states. Their plans and all have to be approved by different authorities. Now some of the assets, specific assets of a project are secured by a loan for that particular project from a financial institution. Whereas another project does not have any secured creditor, only have home buyer's money. Now with this kind of diverse situation, if one of the project gets stuck because of some reason, the whole company is taken to the insolvency process. Now if that happens, which is likely, Unitech is one of the example, or there will be several examples. Having delivered several successful projects, having delivered possession to most of the towers in a one particular project, but stuck with the one particular tower or with half of that particular tower, he will face, the corporate debtor will face the CIRP, insolvency. Now, what is the solution? Well, once the RP is appointed, he will take over all the assets of the company. He will not restrict himself to the particular project. Now, RP is supposed to manage the company as a going concern. So he will take over wherever the assets of the company are situated, and he will take over the entire operations of the company. He will supersede the board of directors. Now, the board of directors who had successfully handed over the projects, successfully implemented several projects, but they got stuck with one particular project, they are superseded, and the RP comes and he is given an authority to keep the company as a going concern, as a substitute to the managing director. He will employ his own team. Now, once he invites the claim of a project which has been successfully implemented, but some of the claims are still pending, those claimants have got nothing to do with the project which has actually got stuck and could not be completed. The secured creditors of another project which is successfully implemented, those have got no security of the asset which has gone into problem and which has gone into trouble, and because of that the CIRP had started. So there are different diverse creditors, different creditors of different projects. Now all these problems, multiple problems, were addressed by the Honorable NCLAT in a judgment called Flat Buyers Association, Winter Hill 77, Gurgaon versus Umang Realtek Private Limited. Now this company went into insolvency on the basis of two applicants. two flat buyers, they could not get the possession, or delayed possession was there. They could not get the possession in time. They filed Section 7 application and the company was admitted to insolvency. The matter went to the appeal because that flat buyers association, they went into appeal. By the time the appeal came for hearing, the RP with the assistance of the promoters, they kept the company as a going concern. And these two particular people who had taken the company to the insolvency, their flats were completed and they were handed over the possession. So balance remaining the project, the NCLAT thought that rather than now inviting another person, why not to invite the promoter himself? And there was one financial creditor also, which was introduced by the promoter. So the promoter himself had arranged finance from another outside promoter. Promoter himself had put his money. So with that money, the company was running and the RP was managing in substitution of the board of directors. So NCLAT said, this is the, they called it, they named it as a reverse corporate insolvency, that why not the promoter should be given a chance with the help of that outside financial creditors. Outside financial creditors was given 30% of the amount receivable or received from the flat buyers, and the balance the promoters organized and they completed the project. Since the original allottees have got their flat, so in any case Section 7 did not sustain, so did not survive. So it was more like a consent order. So the appeal was disposed of in terms of the consent order, that okay, project, the promoters and the outside third party financial creditor, they will implement the project. So that is called reverse insolvency. That was the name given by the NCLAT. Now this judgment as far as today is concerned is final, but then in that same judgment, NCLAT had made very serious observations. One such observation is that constitution of COC. If you see how the COC is constituted, COC will consist of the secured creditors, that's the financial institutions. COC will also have the home buyers who are supposed to be financial creditors as per the definition, explanation added to the Section 518F. So the COC will be constituted by the financial institutions, secured creditors, and the flat buyers. Now in any kind of insolvency resolution plan, the financial creditors are supposed to get the haircut because they'll have to give sacrifice and the resolution plan will be approved. Here, the flat buyers, they cannot get the haircut in the sense that if they have booked a flat of 1500 square feet, they can't be given a flat of 1200 square feet. I mean, they can't be any haircut. They want a flat of 1500 square feet. At best, they can get some semi-finished or less finished. That's all. To that extent, haircut is possible. But they need the complete flat of 1500 square feet, what they had booked. On the other hand, secured creditors, they can't be given the assets of the company, because after all the money, if they have given loan, they will only need loan. So where they only need the refund of loan. So where that money come from? RP cannot raise the fund. RP, in fact, RP also would be doing the same thing as the promoter would have done it. They would have raised funds and given possession to the flat buyers, and whatever money they are recovered, that will be paid to the secured creditors. Now that process could not be completed for various reasons, but the difficulty here in the constitution of COC, which I pointed out, is that the secured creditors, even if the assets are secured with them, they cannot take over those assets because the assets are actually bought by the flat buyers. And the flat buyers cannot part with those assets, whatever consideration they have paid. This is one. The second difficulty which will come. In some of the real estate companies, you must have observed, the land does not belong to that corporate debtor. Land is owned by something else, somebody else. The corporate debtor only has development rights. And the financiers are different who have that land as a collateral. Land ownership is X. Financial creditors, they have a security of that X land, and the flat buyers, they have a right against the developer, where the developer has got no asset. There's no ownership. Developers only have got the development rights. So with all those complications were addressed by the NCLAT, and NCLAT came to the conclusion that in case of real estate industry, rather than having a company-wise resolution plan, the insolvency must be limited to a particular project. So a project-wise insolvency was introduced, that in a real estate company, the CRP will be only limited to that particular project. Because the reason is very obvious, because the other flat buyers in a different project who are also financial creditors, they have got, even if they will form part of that COC, but they have no interest because they are not concerned with this particular project. Their interest is something different. Similarly, there will be a pool of assets at a corporate level. Now, RP will be allowed to use those pool of assets for a particular project. It will be unfair to the other projects. Similarly, there will be corporate liabilities also, which are not project specific, but the liabilities are there of a company. If the company goes into insolvency, naturally those creditors will also come in, even if they have nothing to do with this particular project. So then NCLAT found a solution, and they said, let the resolution be only project specific, and whenever Section 7 application is admitted, it will be only to a project specific. So far, so good. It addresses most of the issues which pertain to the real estate industry. But now, having done this, in fact, I would say the NCLAT has answered some of the questions, but raised several. Several questions which have been raised now after post this judgment. The judgment came in February 20, and it's just a matter of coincidence or whatever would say that this judgment cannot be appealed against because it's a consent order. Nobody is agreed by this judgment. Flat Buyers Association were happy because the project would be complete. The third party financial creditor is there. He will also get 30% of the contribution from the flat buyers, so we'll get his money. Promoters are also happy, and the other flat buyers are also happy. So nobody is agreed by this judgment. So this judgment has attained finality. This is not going into appeal. So as of now, in any real estate industry, the CIRP, if it will be initiated, it will be initiated only project-wise. Now, what are the problems created? What are the questions which have been arisen as a result of this judgment? The first question is from the section 7. Now, section 7 application can be filed by any financial creditor. Now, here it doesn't say that financial creditor of a project. It says financial creditor of a company. Now, if a company have multiple projects, it can be filed by any financial creditor of any project, because that's what the law is. But if you go by this judgment, only the financial creditor of that particular project, that means flat buyers of that projects only, they can go under Section 7 application. Now, second is Section 14, moratorium. Now, if the CIRP is only limited to that particular project, the moratorium can't be against the other assets of the company. But the law is, Section 14 says that the moratorium will be declared on all the assets of the corporate debtor and not particular relating to the specific project. Now, this question remains has not been answered. Third, Section 20. Section 20, which authorizes the resolution professional to manage the operations of a company as a going concern. Now, he resolution professional has been appointed for a corporate debtor. They have not been appointed for a particular project. It cannot be, because otherwise, how will he supersede the board of directors? If the law is that RP will substitute the board of directors, it can't be limited to the project. So RP is duty bound to take over the entire assets and has to manage the entire operations of the company as a whole, not only with regard to the particular project. Now, Section 23, which says the resolution professional shall conduct the entire corporate insolvency resolution process and manage the operation of the corporate debtor during CIRP and not relating to the only that project. So he is in charge of the entire project and they shall conduct the CIRP of the entire project. Now, same thing we are seeing Unitech. You see, Unitech, many projects are already successful. They are already, implemented, possession given, but still the company is suffering, because in some of the cases, you must have seen, the debt buyers themselves have got together for a particular project. They contributed the money and they completed the projects, and with the help of RP and with the help of promoters, they got the possession in a semi-finished condition and then completed the project themselves, taken the possession, but still they filed the claim for the deficiencies, for the handing over of the incomplete projects. So that claim is still valid against the corporate debtor. That's again Unitech. So the RP has to have, RP having given the possession of that particular flat to a particular flat buyer, still has to compile, collate that claim, and that claim still lies against the company. So there's no, even if that flat buyer has got the possession of the flat, even if that particular project has been resolved, even if the CIRP has completed to the extent because the flat buyers have got the possession and company has got nothing to do with it, still the insolvency resolution process of the company is still pending. So now third thing, which is the most important, is Section 29A. If you continue to involve the promoter who's already a defaulter and whose accounts have already become NPA or who's a defaulter, as per Section 29A, those promoters are prohibited to participate in the insolvency resolution process. Now, if you continue to involve the promoter, like the NCLAT has allowed in case of Umang Builder judgment, calling it as a reverse resolution process, then 29A becomes redundant. Or CIRP is in contravention of Section 29A. So both the things can't be correct. 29A can't be held as redundant, and CIRP cannot be against the provisions of the company, provisions of IBC. It cannot be against the Section 29A. Now, again, Section 43, if you read 43, which is a preferential transactions. If RP hands over the possession of some flats to a financial creditor, to a flat buyer, that means that flat buyer is getting a preference over the other creditors of the company. Whereas secured creditors did not get anything because they did not get any money. They are still pending. But some of the flat buyers, they are getting the possession in preference to the secured creditor, which is squarely will file under Section 43. So it is a preferential transactions that also cannot be allowed. Lastly, which Rakesh had touched upon a little bit, that if there's no resolution plan, then what happens? In a normal corporate debtor, if the CRP does not take place, or if there's no resolution plan, then the company goes into liquidation. But here, if you imagine a company which has successfully delivered several projects, or a company has five towers, four towers is already handed over, and one tower remains which has got into problem. Even in that tower also, up to 10th floor, he is already handed over the possession. Beyond 10th floor, 11 floors are only skeleton has been created, or I don't know, that even that also may not have been created. But if that company goes into liquidation, how unfair it is to those buyers, flat buyers, who are already in possession. Maybe sale deed has not been executed, their ownership has not been transferred, but they are in possession. But if it company goes to liquidation, actually that asset belongs to the company, and the RP will take over, or the liquidator will take over, and liquidator will have to dispose of those assets and dispose of those flat buyers. So these are the questions which arises as a result of this judgment, which I think will be answered over a period of time. And we as a professional, let's see how best we can resolve these issues. But on equity, I would say yes, this judgment is very correct on equitable basis, and this is the most viable way of doing it. But if you go through the provisions of law, I think it's against, contrary to several provisions, because then you are only going against the basic basic principle of corporate entity, because corporate entity is one, and that is the reason. In fact, most of the real estate companies you will find, not big companies, but generally middle level real estate companies, they form a SPV only for a project. So their companies will be only limited to a particular project, and maybe that's the right way of doing it. So if you form that particular SPV only for that particular project, and if because of some reason that project gets into difficulty, so only that SPV will get into corporate insolvency process and not the main company as a whole. So that can be the one solution. But then these are the questions which I think the time only will answer. Unfortunately, this company, this judgment has not gone to Supreme Court and will not go to the Supreme Court. And as of now, this company, this judgment is binding on all the benches of NCLT all over India. So till the time any contrary judgment comes, I think we'll have to live with all those questions which are remaining answered. Well, participants, I think that's all I wanted to say. And if there are any questions, which I would be too pleased to answer.
Thank you very much, sir, for sharing the knowledge with us. I think the participants are enlightened with your knowledge, with your views, explaining the basics of reverse CIP. And I, during the registration process, many of the participants have made a question to for the explaining the reverse CIP, which you have very well explained. And in future question will be coming on. But here, before we move further for Q&A session, one or two questions on this aspect, sir. In case of reverse CIP, how the corporate liabilities will be allocated? What is the, I mean, you never know that this corporate liability is for this project and how that will take care.
So that's the question, you know, which definitely needs to be deliberated, because there will be many liabilities which are at corporate level and they are not specific to that particular project. So there will be a difficulty. But if CIRP, you see, the IBC as of now, it talks of the overall CIRP of the corporate debtor. It doesn't talk of CIRP of that particular project. So if, unless that plan, whatever resolution plan comes, whether it's a reverse resolution plan or forward resolution plan is there, unless it takes care of those liabilities at a corporate level, or which are, even if they are not project specific, to my mind, that section, that regulation 38,
yes,
and the requirement of section 30 will not be complete.
Thank you. So, one more question in the same line. What about regarding the voting? I mean, in this case also, the lenders may be different who have given, lended the money, because it may be a corporate lender. He would have the lended the money which is used for some other project or something, but they have a voting share. So how the voting will take place in such condition?
No, see, that you're right. You see, that's the question, in fact, was touched upon by the Honorable NCLT also there. And largely, this judgment has come in the sense that the flat buyers, maybe who are spread over at a different locations, and they may not possess that commercial wisdom to vote on a particular resolution plan. So, because their interest is only limited to their flat. Whereas the financial creditors, the secured creditors, their interest would be overall, because they have appraised the project, they have, and they have the adequate infrastructure also, they have the adequate resources to analyze to this thing. So voting is an issue, because, and that is why, Lordship, that is why this, the rule was amended that in case of flat buyers, the RP will take their consent, and the AR will be appointed, and who will take care of those, this thing, but voting is direct. So obviously that problem is there, because, but most of the time financial creditors will take over, and they, because they gather, they have the, possess the commercial wisdom. So I think that will be helpful. But the flat buyers, yes, they have a difficulty in voting, because they don't have that expertise, and they will not have access to so much of data, so, yes, because their interest is only limited to that particular flat.
Yes. So friends, now we are in the end, and now we will take few of the questions which are coming up. So the questions will be, any of the panelists would like to answer these questions. The questions are many, but within the time limit, we'll spend few minutes on some of the questions over here, sir. So the question is, what is the position of a developer who has entered into JDA where land is owned by the corporate debtor? So what is the position of the developer? I mean, where the developer goes?
Should I answer?
Yeah, please.
Sir, would you like to answer or should I answer?
No, please go ahead. I'll supplement if it is there.
Sir. Yeah. See, there are two things. One is, it's a CRP process of the developer of the landowner. That is very important. If it is a CRP process of the developer and there are right of the landowner through the collaboration agreement, joint development agreement, in that case, that landowner has to file the claim only.
Here the question is that the land is owned by the corporate debtor.
Right.
And JDA is with the developer.
Correct.
So the CRP is going off of the corporate debtor which owns the land. But the developer has the right for developing and all those things. So what happens to that particular developer?
See, developer, ultimately developer through the collaboration agreement has the FAR rights or some unit rights. For that, ultimately RP will take over that project after the CRP order. So in that case, whether it's a landowner or the developer, both will have to file their claims before the RP for their entitlement as per the agreement. Like I will give the live example. In one of the matter, there is a landowner. There is a real estate CRP process going on before the principal bench. And he warned that there was a collaboration agreement. CD did not perform its part. That collaboration agreement should now be treated as a cancelled. And my land should be excluded from the this estate of this CRP process. So that matter is pending. But ultimately, his claim would lie before the RP.
Okay.
See, another thing which you see answering to your specific thing, you know, if the land does not belong to the corporate debtor, the development rights are with the corporate debtor. The answer to that is, one is that group insolvency, because he should also be involved. But then if that doesn't happen, the development rights are only, you know, in case of only by way of possession of the property, and he has to construct and give it back to the flat buyers. So that difficulty definitely is there. But I think the answer to the solution best is the group insolvency, and the landowner also should be included in that.
So there is a question coming up that such developer, what would be the category of this developer? I mean, he would be a financial or operational, what kind of category it would fall a developer?
No, developer would be the corporate debtor, no?
No, no. In a case where the land is owned by the corporate debtor and developer has done the JDA. So developer is a different entity.
Okay.
Here?
Yeah. If here, the developer...
Please, sir.
No, you, please go ahead.
Here, see, Sameer, it's all depends upon the contract. What that joint development agreement provides in such contingencies, like if there's a termination of contract, what are the rights, or otherwise pre-termination? If the developer is to get some units, or in case of termination to have some money along with interest. So if he files a claim for that term, for that money along with interest, he will fall under the financial creditor. Or if he simply claim his right over the land, he will fall under the category, another category, category of the creditors. As I said, in the real estate matter, there are different kind of creditors. It's not a simply financial creditor. It's a class of financial creditor, secured, unsecured, and there are other categories which is based on contingencies.
So actually, you see, these are the contractual rights. The developer will get the contractual rights, because this will only arise from that particular contract. So frankly, I mean, just by saying that he's a developer and whether he'll be categorized as a financial creditor or operational creditor, it won't be fair to classify that, because eventually he's acquiring only those contractual rights through that contract.
Yes.
So whatever that contract says, it'll be fall in that category. Now I see some of the questions, on my screen. Like in case, Sameer, I can read it?
Yes, sir.
In case of reverse CIRP, applicability of section 12A is there or not? No, definitely 12A is applicable to all the CIRP, whether it's a reverse or... Because reverse CIRP, if you see, it does not find anywhere in the Act. This was the name given by the NCLAT in that particular judgment. Otherwise, it's not a term which has been, you know, referred to in any of the Act, any of the provisions. So 12A will be applicable definitely. And in fact, the flat buyers, as I mentioned, that the original applicants one in that judgment which I dealt with, they got the possession. So that is why they were not aggrieved. And flat buyers association was also appellate in that judgment, in that case, were also not aggrieved. So the matter went over. So eventually it was 12A only. I mean, not in so many words, but practically it happened because it was a consent order. So, and one judgment, one question I see, Ayush Gupta, that some amendment should be brought to introduce the project specific insolvency for real estate. That, of course, I agree, because I said, because it's contrary to law, though, of course, on equity, NCLAT has done a good job, but it is contrary to law. So I think law will have to address those specific questions.
So there were earlier questions also sent. So one question is about the EMIs issue. Just may throw light some on the EMI issue in project financing, the home buyers who are giving the EMI and those things regarding the moratorium and what would happen with those EMIs.
Rakesh, question to you.
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah. Update the EMI issues and deferment of interest. I mean, the home buyers who are running EMIs and the moratorium has been given. So what is the state for that? Just somebody has just to summarize that, what is the status on EMIs at the moment?
No, no, moratorium.
The moratorium which was announced by the government.
No, no, because of that COVID.
Yes, yes, yes.
That COVID moratorium.
Yes, so yes, yes.
Okay, I mean, it's got nothing to do with IBC, of course, but that I think the banks have been regularly clarifying. I mean, this is my understanding that it's only a moratorium on the payment, but there's no moratorium on the interest part.
Okay.
But that's what I read, of course, whatever has been there, but that's what it is.
So, in this, some views on the exclusion of CIRP period, where in most of the real estate projects where some approvals are pending or because of some reasons the timelines are getting so, and we have a limit of 330 days. So how do you see that these exclusions would work, or how 330 days can be within these things can be done?
As of today, there is no exclusion.
Yeah.
You know, because exclusion used to be earlier when it was 270 days. And because of that NCLAT judgment, the period used to be excluded. But now there is no exclusion. It says 330 days and that's all about it. But then because of the Supreme Court judgment, we say 330 days is only a directory. It's not mandated. So extensions are being granted. There's no exclusion.
Okay. So if there are certain delays for their extensions can be granted.
Extensions are being granted, but there's no exclusion of a particular period. An extension can be now because of this COVID. I think most of the schemes, most of the CRP period will get extended.
And Sameer, there are already a circular by IBBI, one circular, and by the Honorable Enclate or Sumoto order that this period will not counted for this CRB process. And Section 40A is there already.
Yes, yes.
And
yes,
yes. As per judgment, the Honorable Supreme Court already directed, clarified that in some exceptional circumstances, even period may go beyond 330 days also.
Yes. So one more question is coming up. Either of the panelists may like to have it. If a real estate company goes into CIRP process, what will happen to flat owners who has already got the possession but no registered sale deed is yet executed? So they don't have the sale deed is not executed, but that they have got the possession. So what is their status when it goes into CIRP?
That is what I said. You know, in this case, see, effectively, the what is the effect of this transaction? That asset is still owned by the company.
Yes.
And the flat buyer has only given a payment. Maybe 90%, 70%, 80%. So as long as it is company's asset, RP has a right to take over. So whether, but the eventually in case of real estate, because resolution is only to give possession to the buyer and on balance payment. So that of course will happen, but technically, strictly speaking, that asset belongs to the company and the RP has a right to take over. And RP will only accept the claim to the extent of amount which is paid by him, which is inequitable. But then whatever, I mean, that's the strictly legal position.
Sameer, I would like to add that in one of the matter I'm paying for the RP, in that real estate matter, and in some of the home buyers, they have paid the substantial amount, they have the possession also. So even in some cases, when the sale deeds are being executed by the RP, because as per the IBC, RP has to run the CD as a going concern. So during that going concern, even if the RP has to collect the balance payments also, so even the sale deed and possessions have been given.
For the, so it the, means where sale deed is not executed, they can ask the RP to get the sale deed done.
If they can are ready to pay the balance amount, and RP has the obligation to run the affairs of CD as a going concern.
Okay, sir, we are approaching our time. So it is very interesting. But before we close, we'll take up the last thing. So in real estate projects where resolution plan has already been approved by the COC, or may I say even filed with the adjudicating authority, but due to COVID situations, things, circumstances have changed, economic scenario has changed, maybe return on investment and many things would have changed, or the funding which he would have arranged would have mismanaged. So can that the resolution applicant take back the resolution plan and amend it? And what is the views on this?
No, I think, see, once the application under Section 30 is filed, the legal position is that COC will not have much say on that. But looking at the present situation, he can definitely approach COC. COC can amend that plan and then file with the adjudicating authority. But to my mind, I think adjudicating authority will say that no, whatever plan is there, that has to be final. So if somebody wants to withdraw, then whatever consequences of withdrawal by the resolution applicant are there, that should follow.
Yes, sir.
It's a difficult situation because definitely, but unless the government comes out with that particular, clarification or by modification, but once application Section 30 is filed,
then logically it seems different, but legally it stands that way.
And yeah. Sameer,
so he definitely can amend and then maybe file a revised application. Because technically, you see, if the COC withdraws that Section 30 application and with the liberty to file a revised, they can do it. So by withdrawing that, and then the COC will consider and file a revised application.
And sir, you are correct, sir. If this adjudicating authority, they don't have power. Once plan is approved, they can't look into accept the clerical errors. And in such circumstances, at the most, resolution applicant can file an application to adjudicating authority to ask the COC to reconsider it. At the most, but ultimately, as you said, sir, correctly, the COC has to consider it.
COC only, actually, because adjudicating authority can't. That's a judgment by NCLAT that adjudicating authority cannot amend the plan.
They can't amend the plan. Correct.
Sir. Either amend, they can either accept or reject.
Correct, sir.
So there is a question coming up that can a resolution applicant ask for the waiver of statutory duties? I think we have done these things many times, but at least you can again give explanation to this.
That because statutory duties are operational creditors. I think Rakesh has answered
that. Yes. It's a established thing now at the moment. Or one is asking, can an RP make sales during the CIRP? So I think he has to keep the company going concerned. And he is fully authorized to do that. So, sir.
All right.
Yeah, I think we have crossed our time, in fact, but it was really a wonderful session. And both the panelists have really given insight into the subject. And we all attendees and myself, we have enjoyed the deliberations. And with this, I thank the panelists and thank you all the attendees who have been with us for more than one and a half hour and listening to the attending this webinar. Thank you all of you. We'll have you at next webinar. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sameer.